you, Senator Enzi. Very nice introduction. I want to say good morning to everybody. Thank you very much for being here. It's a diverse group. I want to thank all the people that helped make this happen for this conference. And in particular, I want to take some time to recognize Senator Enzi. I mean, what a privilege for me to be introduced by Senator Enzi. Senator, as I look out across the room here, this is because of your efforts and because of your vision. And I can tell you right now, without having called every state, I know this morning that we are the only state in the country where you have two U.S. senators in the same room with all of you looking at small business. Senator Barrasso, Senator Enzi, if you have any doubt in your mind about their care of Wyoming and their care of small business, just look to this table and see them. Let's give them both another round. You know, it's great to have them both, and I look to both of them for guidance and ideas. And when I see Senator Enzi chairing the budget committee, and his challenge is, as he pointed out, that there hasn't been a budget in 6 years. And I think about just my challenge on looking at a budget every year, and I don't know how you're gonna go back in time and fix that, but he's got some great ideas, including the one penny idea, that if we saved one penny on everything we did in 3 years, we'd have a balanced budget. And for us, for you, you know, in small business, thinking about saving one penny on every dollar doesn't seem like a hard lift. Let me just tell you, the further you get up in government, it's a harder and harder lift. But if there's a man that can get it done, it's Senator Enzi, and we look forward to that, and we look forward to his continued success in terms of his 80-20 rule. You know, he works on those things where he can get things done. He and Senator Barrasso keep an amazing schedule. I just talked to Senator Barrasso this morning, and we ought to put him in charge of also revising the Wyoming map, because he's everywhere all the time. He can let us know the population of every small town. So great to be with both of you. And again, thank you both for your leadership. I am pleased to be here. Somebody remarked it must be hard for you to get away during this time of year with the legislature in session. And you know, my view is it is hard to be here, but it's also so lovely to be here. And if this is a 5-day conference, I would love to stay. I just love it. But apparently I have to be back soon, so I'm sorry I can't be with you for the entire conference. But I want to share a few comments with you. One is, you know, why do we care so much about small business? As we look at the state of Wyoming and the condition of the state of Wyoming, we're in good shape, and it is because of small business. It is a small business that provides so much in terms of employment. And employment, we often talk about in terms of a number. You know, this is the percentage of unemployment. These are the number of people you have employed. And I would just tell you, for us, you know, last summer we had more Wyoming people employed than we've ever had in the history of our state. And that's a statistic. That's a statistic, but why do we care so much about it? What it means is that we have more people that are able to take care of themselves, take care of their families, and especially as I talk to young people and I talk about the value of employment, it's not just a career, it's not just a way to put food on the table. It's one of the wonderful ways that we have for developing our character and developing self-esteem, to be able to be employed, to do something of value. I remember my grandfather, he was well into his 80s. He was, I think, 87, 89 years old, and he was interviewed by the paper, and he was asked, what are some of the things you're most thankful for? And he said, I've always been thankful that I've had a job to do every day. I've had a job to do that I can get up in the morning, and there's something I can do that makes a difference. And so when we think about employment, it is not just a statistic. It's what it does for the individual who has the benefit of a job. And so for small business people, thank you for that. For all of you here today, and we think about what is going on in Wyoming, just I want to give you a little bit of a state of the state. We have been working to set the table for small business in every way that we can, recognizing the value of it. And one of the ways that I thought it was important to do that is for us at the state level to have smaller government. And in fact, we do. We have fewer people employed now than we did 4 years ago. We have consolidated our agencies. We have worked hard to be as efficient as possible for business. And as Senator Enzi mentioned, we are recognized in many ways as one of the best states in the country to do business, including the fact that we have the best tax structure for small business. We have the lowest tax burden in the country. And we hope all of you see that as a benefit, as we see it as a benefit. We have been rated the best in terms of being business friendly. And this past year, 2014, we were rated as having the second fastest growing GDP in the country. We love that. But what it requires is those of you in small business to continue the work you do, to continue the success that you have. So with that, I want to tell you some of the things that we have been working on and some of the challenges that we have. First is, for those of you who've been following, you know that minerals provide about 70 to 80% of our revenue on any given year for the state of Wyoming. And so when you see oil prices fall to around $50, it has an impact, and I want you all to be aware of this. Just for an example, every $5 that oil decreases, it's about a $35 million loss to the state of Wyoming. So in June of this year, oil was about $104, and now it's about $50. You can do the math, it's $225 million loss in revenue to the state of Wyoming. Creates a challenge. Now, as significant as oil is, even more significant to the state is natural gas. Here's an example. 2 years ago when I was putting my budget together, we have a group called the Consensus Revenue Estimating Group, and they say, Gov, here's the amount of money we think is going to be available based upon our estimates of different minerals and tourism and ag. And so I prepared my budget based upon their estimates, and then in January, right before the session started, they said, oops, we think it's going to be, natural gas prices are going to be 25 cents per MCF lower. 25 cents. 25 cents, that's what you have to worry about, Gov. I had to take $115 million out of my budget based on that 25 cents. So we've got a couple things going on. We have low oil prices, we have low natural gas prices, we have tremendous pressure on coal right now. So all the more reason that we have to have resilient, tough, and good working small businesses in the state of Wyoming. We will get through this. It's not Wyoming's first rodeo on this deal. We've seen it before, and we are well positioned by having our rainy day fund almost double the last 4 years, having our permanent fund increased by about 55% the last 4 years. We will get through this. The challenge for us is, and the challenge I think for all of you is, we need to send out the message loud and clear. Wyoming is not closing down for business. Wyoming is going to continue to grow. We're going to continue to sustain. We're going to continue, even during the hard times, to have a trend line that is positive. That is my message for you, and it's my message to the legislature. The worst thing we could do is say, man, this is a disaster. We're going to hide in the corner. We're going to put everything under the mattress, because it will be a self-fulfilling prophecy. We need to continue to build. We need to continue to diversify. And one of my main goals, starting 4 years ago, was with the question of diversity. And you can go back and you can look at almost every governor's state of the state address, and there's a couple things in common. One, we all say good morning. That's always in there. And the other thing that's always in there is we need to diversify our economy. And it's true, we do need to diversify, because when 70 or 80% comes from a particular industry sector, when you see a downturn, man, the ripple effect is huge. So we do need to diversify, but the way to diversify is figure out where your strengths are. Where can you diversify? And as I've said jokingly, somewhat jokingly, hey, we're never going to become the surfing capital of the country. It ain't happening. We need to find our strengths, and we have so many strengths, from our low taxes to a workforce that has a work ethic that I don't think is matched anywhere. We have year in and year out about the lowest electricity cost. How can we diversify? And what is the need? Where can we diversify? And for me, it was technology, because technology is a great equalizer in a rural state. With regard to telemedicine, teleeducation, telecommuting, it puts this very large but very small populated state. It allows us to connect to each other in a way that we couldn't before, and allows us to connect to the world. For you all to sell your product, not just to Cheyenne or to Cody, but to Taiwan, to Japan. This is where we want to go. And so this is the area that I have said we have. Number one, proud to have minerals as our number one industry. Proud to have tourism as our number two industry. Proud to have ag as our number three industry. But not only in our minds and on our lips, but in fact, we can make as our fourth largest industry technology. We can do that and we should do that, not only for the diversity it provides for the economy, but equally important, the diversity it provides for our young people who are growing up in Wyoming in terms of the choices they can make. You know, maybe I don't want to be in ag. Maybe I don't want to be in tourism. Certainly, maybe you don't want to be in politics. What else can be out there? Technology provides so much, and it is an expectation of technology in our younger generations. You know, it's like me with a rotary phone. If I would have gone to college somewhere or gone to a career somewhere and they said, hey, we don't have a rotary phone, I would have said, well, geez, you're not really with it. For our kids, they're growing up with these things. They have an expectation of technology, and we have an ability to provide it. So on that front, some of the things that we've done in this state that hopefully or you have recognized, or if not, have been helpful to you in either event. One is when I came into office, we had different agencies using different email systems. And as a result of that, so I could say, hey, I want to email so-and-so. And my email system would say, in effect, it didn't actually say this, but the result was, they don't work here. And they'd be sitting next to me, yes, I do work here. I know you work here. We didn't have email systems that were consistent. So doesn't seem like a big deal for all of you because you know this, but we got everybody on state on the same email system. And so when we think about innovation that's required for the private sector and small business, some of these things, you know, you're so far ahead of us, but we look to innovate in government as well. And let me tell you, it's a target-rich environment. There's lots of opportunities to innovate. So that was the one. It's, you know, not a big deal, but important. We're all on the same email system. The other thing is we started consolidating our electronic services, our technology, so that we didn't have every agency sort of having its own group of technology people. Instead, we have a single group that provides technology for all our agencies. The other thing we've done and worked very hard on is recruitment of companies. Here's my view on economic development. Number one priority is keep the businesses that are here. Make sure you're taking care of them. That's the number one priority, because if you say, what we're going to do is go recruit, but you haven't treated the businesses that are here well, good luck recruiting. Number one priority is make sure we're doing a good job at the government level to keep the businesses that are here, to make sure that they're doing well. Second is to try to recruit. I have worked hard, I have traveled around the country and around the world to recruit to Wyoming, and we have such a great story to tell. We have such a tremendous story to tell, and people around the world are looking for a state like Wyoming to do business in, to move to, or to do business with people who have a business in Wyoming. And I can sell that message because the story is so true. The other thing we've done with regard to technology is we have, last session I asked the legislature for money to build a unified network in the state of Wyoming. What this does, it provides 100 gigabit backbone to the entire state. 100 gigabit backbone, and it provides redundancy. Now, this is for state buildings and for schools, but what's really exciting about it is it allows the private sector to tap into that. To have that amount of connectivity and that amount of speed is remarkable, because as I've looked at other governors' state-of-the-state addresses this year, we have, you know, states with, you know, 5 times, 10 times our population, the governor's talking about, we have the ability to have this type of speed. We've already got it in Wyoming. We already have it. It is up and running as of a couple months ago. We hope for small businesses that you take full advantage of that opportunity. And we see in recruitment, we see in the unified network, we see in our low taxes, our low cost of electricity, our wonderful workforce, the results. And that's why yesterday I announced that Microsoft is adding to their investment in Wyoming. $750 million. Now, if I would have told you 4 years ago, we're going to have a company invest $750 million in Wyoming, and it's not related to tourism, ag, or minerals, you would have thought, this guy is crazier than we actually anticipated. But it has happened, and it's going to continue to happen. We are building momentum, and we hope that you all take full advantage of that, and we hope we get your feedback on what else we can do. Because, in fact, when I talk about the future of Wyoming, when I talk about what is your interest, are you interested in education, are you interested in family services, are you interested in health?
have any interest you want, but if you don't have the private sector thriving, you're not going to be able to make changes. You're not going to be able to go where you want on education or healthcare or roads, because we need the private sector. That is where you start. The private sector has to thrive for government to do the things it needs to do well. And on that front, we continue to work on infrastructure issues across the state, because the other part of economic development is you can have a great business, but good luck keeping people or recruiting people if you don't have running water, sewer, roads, and bridges. We put and are trying to put additional funds into infrastructure. We'll continue to work on that. We have been leading in manufacturing. Our manufacturing has increased considerably more than the national average. We have challenges, however, and one of the challenges we have certainly is with regard to health care. We have the two senators who are as adept at working on the health care issue as any, and they are going to continue to work to find fixes with the ACA, which is appropriate. But we recognize this: for a business to not have the ability to tell your employees that you're going to have adequate health care, that if your child breaks their arm, that you're not going to have to drive 70 miles, or if you're looking for prenatal care in January, the message is you have to drive 100 miles in January to get prenatal care. That is not good for business. And the other fact is Wyoming, we lead in many ways. In one area we lead that is not good is we have the highest health care costs in the country. So it is a challenge, and it's a challenge I haven't figured out, and it's a challenge the legislature hasn't figured out. We have to figure it out, and it's something we're going to continue to work on, but we need to hear from the private sector on what we can do better and what you would anticipate we can do better. And we know that the senators, our congressional delegation, are going to continue to make fixes on it, and we look forward to that. So in summary, for all of you who are here from the federal side, let me just say some of you are from Wyoming, some of you came outside from Wyoming, and we very much appreciate that. But we're glad you're here, because by you being here and working with Wyoming small businesses, not only will you have a chance to help that Wyoming small businesses in this wonderful state, but the business that you work with in Wyoming, they're going to provide a great value, great work, great product. You couldn't do better than the companies in Wyoming. So we thank you all. Senator Enzi, Senator Brassel, thank you both. And thank you for giving me some time. And I want, if I need, a note from all of you that I was here, I wasn't ditching, I was legitimately here, and the legislature should be forgiving me. So thank you all very much. Have a great night.